they put Don in Shriners. And because he was getting totally...
wild.
No, not only wild, but I mean he charmed the maid to tying his shoes in the morning. That sort of thing.
Yeah.
Anything, you know, anything she could do for him was to be done. Yes. And he came home for Christmas, and he was a changed man, Greg. I mean, he was a man. He wore his uniform, he was standing straight, all that jazz. And no, he was different.
Yeah.
He could even make his bed and bounce a dime on it or whatever they do to prove they can do it right. And then after that he had several years in Mexico City, and then he went into Wharton School, and he graduated from there. And he worked, I don't know that you know this, but he worked in an insane asylum.
No, I didn't know that.
Yes, to make extra money.
What, up in Philadelphia? Huh? In Philadelphia?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And he worked as a model.
Really?
Yeah, he modeled clothes.
Huh.
And he was the president of his fraternity.
Yeah. I knew that.
And then Ronnie, whom you've met, was
Tony
another
Hobbs.
Devil.
Yeah.
And the two of them together, you know, they could set off fireworks. Ronnie had graduated from I don't know where, and he was going to join the Navy because he wanted to fly planes.
Right.
Oh, no, Don came home after graduation. And he worked, I think, for about 6 months with an American man who had sold insurance. And he was selling insurance.
He was down in New Orleans, right?
In Mexico City.
Oh, Mexico City. Okay.
Yeah. And then he and Ronnie decided that they wanted to fly planes. They weren't married, and they had no commitments, and it just sounded like a great idea. So they climbed up and they became jet pilots.
What did you guys think about that at the time when he signed up for that, or wanted to?
Well, that's what he wanted to do.
Right.
You know, we weren't going to argue with him. It wasn't so much about the war
at the time.
No. It was something he wanted to do. He wanted to fly.
Now, Ronnie didn't stay in. He was only in for a couple of years, right? Ronnie,
yeah. He got out.
Yeah.
But Don decided to stay. And to this day, I think I've told you this. I told Jennifer, I know. I think that he was flying into Laos.
Oh, you don't think what they told us is true?
No. I think that at the time, they were flying into Laos and bombing, and they didn't admit it. And I think that's what happened to him. I think that he was shot down somewhere. I really don't think that he died the way he did. And it infuriates me that his name is not on the wall.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I am incensed. I mean, what was he doing, even if he died in the China Sea doing a practice?
He was over there for that reason.
What was he there for? Fun?
Yeah.
I mean, he was a major pilot.
Yeah.
And they don't recognize that? Please. That makes me damn mad.
Yeah, me too.
You know, I love my country. There are many things I love about it, but there are some things I really don't like. That is one. It just breaks my heart that he... how cruel.
just doesn't fit in the box. That's why. It just didn't. His story doesn't fit in their box.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Your mother must have been heartbroken.
She never talked about that. She didn't talk.
She never talked about it.
Yeah.
Your mother was very
heartbroken about losing him. Yes.
Oh, yes.
About him being on the wall. Never talked about it.
No. Yeah. But it must have upset her like hell.
Must have.
No, there was no reason why he shouldn't have been, except that they wanted to keep it secret. And I have a pilot friend, a Navy pilot friend who's retired, and I told him about this, and he said, "You're probably right." He said, "I wouldn't be surprised."
Which means all these friends that have come around that were flying with him that night, that say they were with him, are lying.
Right. No, that broke my heart. But
so, growing up, back to a simpler time, what was Mexico City like when you lived there?
Oh, it was wonderful. So wonderful. It was like Austin, 15, 20 years ago when I got here, only far more interesting. I mean, it was so cosmopolitan. There were people from all over the world had congregated there. The Russians that had been, left their country because of the revolution. The Germans had made inroads there. They had a large colony. The French, everybody seemed to be represented. And we all got along, at least the kids did. We never discussed politics. And yet it was during the war. We just didn't. But we were all very concerned about the war. But we didn't talk about, blaming anybody for anything, and we didn't really get into it much. But
so at this point, did Gigi like Mexico City, living there?
Oh,
as opposed
sure.
to the jungle.
Of course. Oh yes.
Yeah.
No, and lots of interesting people, and of course this is Gigi thrived on that, it was a fascinating place to live. And beautiful, and terribly sophisticated. I mean, it's so different from anything that we ever knew in Texas that it was just fascinating. And it was developing so quickly.
How long did it, at what point did you kind of realize that Mexico City, as you originally knew it, was no longer...
Mexico City what?
Had changed, was no longer what you had grown, initially...
Oh, I still think that it's a fascinating place. I still think it's, I have friends that live there and they live a very good life. They have drivers and they have security, but they don't bother the foreigners the way they do the locals. They respect that. At least they have in the past. Now with Trump, who knows? They'd probably kill us. we were sort of untouchable. In fact, they used to call us Los Intocables because there were repercussions if we were harmed in any way. International repercussions, and the school was interesting. We had good teachers, and very intelligent teachers. I mean, remarkable, many of them, and and Cuernavaca was beautiful. We'd go there for the swimming in order to visit friends on the weekend, and the movie houses were elaborate and terribly attractive, and big buildings and big, you know, theaters, real theaters. They weren't movie houses. The food was interesting. The weather was divine. You couldn't ask for better. Flowers everywhere, music, Xochimilco, you know, and there were serenades. And when I first moved there, you know, the Reforma. Now there's a main street down it, but they used to have what they called a camellón, which is a bridle path.
Oh, okay.
And on Sundays, all of the jinetes would wear the women, you know, in their habits, and the men with their charro pants and everything would all come with their beautiful horses down, all the way down to where the Hilton is. And it was so elegant, really elegant. People traveled and they were all very well educated.
And when did Uncle Richie show up there?
Mm-hmm.
When did Uncle Richie come?
He came right after the war. He decided that Pap was the one that decided to get him involved, in fact. And he did, and then Pat went broke, and then that's when he started coffee hunting on his own.
Now, he had been a chaplain in the military, right?
Yeah. And he came back a changed man.
In what way?
He became a businessman, and I mean a cutthroat businessman. He was in for the money.
Yeah.
But evidently, he had a terrible experience, you know, in the war.
Well, is there such a thing as a good experience?
No, but I mean, yeah. He carried a dead man, I don't know how long, in Italy, and didn't realize he was dead. And it left him scarred. Although he still went to Sunday school and everything like that, but I mean, then he'd go to have business on Monday, and it was a whole new ballgame. He was out, you know, for business. I don't know. I don't know. Uncle Richie was—he was complicated after the war. I think he was a very sweet, sweet man before, but then I didn't. I know that. He loved me. He was a good deal. He used to play Santa Claus. And he would come, he would excuse himself for Don and me and say he had to go get something at the pharmacy or something. And he'd come in. And I was so little that the first time he scared me so much that I wet on him. And then about a year later, I crept up into the attic, and I shouldn't have, of course,
and
I found
his
suit. Yeah. Oh, and I was just crushed.
Yeah.
Crushed. But he was sweet with me.
Yeah.
He was sweet with me, too.
Yes, he was.
He's a good guy.
Did you know him pretty well?
I think I did. Pretty
no,
well.
Great.
I mean, I visited him, you know, with him several times down in Mexico City on my own.
Well, he was just as sweet as could be. Very hardworking man.
Oh, my Lord. A workaholic.
And
just
really,
like Richie Jr.
Well,
all
and
of
Patty.
Them. Patty.
Patty is a tremendous success story.